Hello, everyone. We're going to get started. There'll probably be a few people drift in as we go. So my name is Steve Roach. I'm from Austin, Texas. I've spent a lot of time earlier here in Austin or in Dallas. I'm happy to be here. I'm the moderator for today's session on access to clinical care. First, a few announcements and housekeeping. We want to thank our visionary technology sponsor, Dr. Bonnie and Jonathan Rothberg and their family. Also, welcome everyone who is joining us on the live stream. So, we'll try to, if you have questions, we'll try to get those into the conversation. Today's session is sponsored by Marinus Pharmaceuticals. After each session, we ask you to fill out a survey about the session. For each survey you submit, you'll be entered into a drawing for a daily prize. I have no idea what the daily prize is, but hopefully it's something really good. So so with that, in the way of background, I would like to start by maybe having each of our panelists introduce themselves, maybe with, let's see, name and where you're from and kind of what's your loose connection, why are you here? So let's start with Darcy.
So I'm Darcy Krueger. I'm from Cincinnati Children's Hospital and a TSC clinic director there. And I'm here because I want to be here.
That's true. We really didn't want him here, but he... Anyway, next.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Joao García. I'm child neurologist, pediatric neurologist. I live in Merida, Mexico. And I'm director of the TS clinic in Merida, Mexico. It's the first clinic in the country, one of the first of, I hope, a lot of them later. And well, I'm very happy being here because we don't going to stop to seeing the way to get access for more and more people in our country for specialized services related to the TSC disorder.
Hi, my name is Oded Volovelsky. I'm a pediatric nephrologist from Hadassah Hebrew University Medical Center in Jerusalem, Israel. And I'm also a PI of a research lab on TSC kidney disease.
Somebody start.
I'll start. Hello, everybody. My name's Carla Fladrowski. I'm a mum. I want to be here and I need to be here. I'm the co-chair of TSC Italy, and I'm also the co-chair with Mika of the European Tuberous Sclerosis Association. And one of these days I'll learn how to say sclerosis in all languages.
Good afternoon. I'm Pradnya, Gadgil. I'm a pediatric neurologist, and I'm the director of a TSC clinic in Mumbai, India. We are the babies of the TSC International Alliance, which is 3 years old. And I'm just so happy to be here learning how we can collaborate so that we can extend the same level of TSC care to patients and families back home.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Micaela Rozenberg. I'm from Portugal. I have two daughters, and my youngest, who's not that young anymore, she's 26 years, she has TSC. I'm the president of the Portuguese Association. I'm co-chairing European TSC Association together with Carla. Very happy to be here.
So thank you, everyone. So a couple of things I think that would make today go a bit better. First, this is a fairly broad topic, so access to care in the United States may mean something very different from access to care in Israel or Mexico or Italy or wherever you are. and we want this to be useful for everyone. So if we can, at least for the first part of the session, if we can maybe talk about access in general and maybe not too specifically about, you know, my child had this or that, I think there'll be plenty of time in the next hour and a half to ask those kind of questions as well. Plus, most of us will probably be around afterwards. The second thing is if you would maybe address the questions to me, or you know, if you know specifically who you want to address it, then I will farm it out to one or more of the folks and keep us on track. Is that reasonable? And then I assume I meant to ask this ahead of time, and I'm in the lights, I can't even see our rep here, but I assume the folks who are on live stream can probably submit the questions there on the chat, and somebody will get them to us. Is that? Okay, so that is correct. So anyway, so just to get us going, one of the things, you know, most of the things about this pandemic that seems to go on and on are not very good, but there are a few useful things about it. I think most of us have gotten far more comfortable seeing patients remotely with telemedicine and things like that. And so one of the questions that I would like to ask for me, and maybe this will be different in the different countries, is what effect, if any, would telemedicine have on access to care where care is not readily available? So, any of you? So, why don't you take that? I'm going to ask everybody, so you may as well start.
Right. I'll start. So, in Portugal, yeah, it was a challenge. In the beginning, with the lockdown, everything shut down, and I know that the clinics, the doctors were calling the patients, and slowly they started to do the telehealth. But even the telehealth has some challenges, because we know from some families who the children were taking seizure medications, and they were, during the pandemic, their weight was, they were gaining weight. And this was not aware to the pediatric neurologist, and so the seizures started to increase. So there's a lot of aspects with the telehealth that is very, very good and very convenient, but there are a lot of hidden information that you really have to ask the parents in order not to miss this.
Dr. García, I'd be interested to hear what you have to say about that.
Thank you. Well, this, sorry. At least the first year of the pandemic, some big hospitals that they attend the mostly with all the services, the patients of TSC, they have a kind of conversion. You know? They stop working on the regular visits and they all the infrastructure disposed to attend COVID patients. And the experience in our clinic was that we begin to knew more patients and get connected in this way, many more patients. And that was good because we could help people that they couldn't know what was the next step of epileptic medication or some issues or problems they went, we could help them. And since then, till now, we are using a lot of this form of and extending our the opportunity to see these families and increasing our services to them. And some of them now, they visit our clinic for first time, but maybe in a year we were seeing them by a conference or telemedicine, and it works very, very good for us. And that was a great for us opportunity to know the people know that we have a clinic in some part of Mexico, and that is now some of the opportunity that we know we have to keep working with them in that way.
Darcy?
So one of the things that's been good about the pandemic is that the medical system, at least in the United States, was kind of forced to move forward and become modern. This is a system in the United States that we still have beepers, and we still use fax machines when there are obviously much more efficient and effective ways to communicate nowadays. So along that lines, although telemedicine has existed in the United States for some time, it took the pandemic to really force hospitals and administrators and even physicians to take that on board. But now, because those artificial obstacles have been resolved, we are able to see patients from much farther distances nowadays. And one of the things that we've always struggled with is, like, what do I do when I live in a country or I live in a state or I live in a region that doesn't have a TSC center readily close by? And I think that's one positive thing that through telemedicine we're able to do consultation a lot more. We still have limitations though. In the United States, each state gets to set its own licensing rules, and our ability to do legal telemedicine consultations is severely restricted by whether or not a particular provider has a license in a particular state. And those licensing fees can cost anywhere from $500 to $3,000 every year, and so many hospitals aren't willing to pay those fees for us. So we're moving forward, and a lot of TSC centers, at least regionally, have been able to expand their footprint. And then also, because we have this technology worked out, I think it's allowed us to cross borders across countries a lot more effectively to get a TSC expertise. So I think that's been a positive step forward.
Yeah, I would agree. And you know, Texas, for example, is a very big place. And if you draw a line from Fort Worth, about 25, 30 miles west of where we are, down through Austin and San Antonio, there's basically not very many options west of that line. And fortunately for everybody, there's not that many people out there either. But there's a lot. And, you know, there's some towns that are large enough that under usual circumstances would have more options, or maybe their own clinic or whatever. And so even within the state, you know, where licensing is for us not a problem, you know, we made a decision fairly early on into the pandemic that we're going to try very hard to get someone to come to our clinic at least the first time so that we can make sure that we've got a good, accurate exam and data and so on. But then after that, we're going to at least try our best to make as much of the care available, telemedicine as possible, because I mean, the drive between, say, Lubbock, Texas, and Austin, I've made that drive. I'm never going to make it again. It's, it's like 8 hours each way, and there's nothing to break up the scenery except a few thousand windmills, which we found out the hard way last year that, when there's very, very cold weather, the wind dies. And so as great as they are at making energy, not so good, you know, in times where you really need it. But anyway, we're going to keep doing that. I would agree that's a big step forward. What about Europe, Italy?
Well, in Italy, we were the responsible at the very beginning of COVID. We were sort of locked down almost immediately, and that was a really big problem. And I suppose it might be a little bit like in Texas, because we had people traveling to the Milan Clinic, which is one of the major clinics in Italy. We had people beforehand, before COVID obviously, traveling to the Rome clinic and to the Florence clinic, or in the Tuscany clinic. And those were the three major areas. What we found was when we realized that the problem would be ongoing, we transferred to telemedicine. So, and that worked really well with updating treatments and stuff like that. But one thing that I think could be a problem, or was a problem, was things like MRIs and doing EEGs and stuff like that to see what was actually going on, because we weren't allowed into the hospital. I think we're keeping partial telemedicine also in Italy now because of those distances, and it really does help with those, but you don't have that multisystemic approach that's going on, which is really, really needed, I think. If we can sort that part out, it might be even better. but it has solved a lot of problems with distance and stuff like that.
India?
Back in India. So I think the first part of COVID and the second part of COVID was very different for us, the first year and the second year. First year, I think we had the same challenges. Everything just shut down. Especially patients who had an emergency, who went into status and so on, it got very difficult to get even basic care across to them because hospitals just weren't allowing patients in. However, the adaptation that we saw was really quick. So we already had telemedicine, and it just became that much more smoother. Better tools evolved, people's acceptance improved, and our licensing laws changed very quickly. We were very quickly allowed to see patients from wherever, even international. So I'm the only TSC clinic in Asia, and I started seeing patients from Sri Lanka and Bangladesh doing teleconsults. But I was able to do that because the licensing laws just very quickly allowed me to do it and even prescribe medications in a teleconsult. However, the difficult bit initially was vigabatrin. While all the other medications were all fine, we already had a problem with supply of vigabatrin, and it went from bad to worse to zero. And that was a huge problem. We had a couple of my patients go into acute withdrawal, requiring a hospital admission because they were having vigabatrin, and the next day they were not getting any. Thankfully, again, in the second part of the year, again, drug regulation changed very quickly, recognizing all these problems. And we actually got two companies starting to make vigabatrin in India. So the second year of COVID looked so much better. We were having locally made, much more affordable, good quality vigabatrin, whereas earlier it was imported and we just went to a zero because everything just stopped. So it's been a mixed bag with COVID, but I think a lot of positive things have emerged because there were problems, and people in general, the administration have tried to solve them. Not ideal, but at least, you know, it gets us one step closer to better things.
Last but not least, Israel.
So actually, I think that COVID-19 was very positive for the health system and TSC therapy in my area. The first advancement was that the insurance companies have approved to have telemedicine and online visits to be exactly like a regular visit. And now, even now, if a patient is preferring and I approve that he will not come to the clinic, but we will do it online, the insurance company accept it. And because the insurance company accept it, the hospital very rapidly incorporated the online system into our software, like the Epic in the US. So actually now when the time of the visit arrive, I can just press the button, I can see the patient and can review the imaging and all the lab results together. And actually patients really like it. But what is amazing that although now they don't have to come to hospital, people really still prefer the human and the one-on-one visits. And like we missed these conferences, and I hated this webinar and this online meeting that I sit at home. So people still want to meet their physician and the medical team, even they don't have to do it right now.
Thanks. So let's open it up. How about you guys? Questions, comments? If you're going to do this, there's mics at least at the middle. So if anybody has questions, yeah, we got one coming up now.
I just have a couple of things. First off, so we live in Las Vegas, Nevada. My son's 24. And we haven't been to the UCLA clinic for years because the last time we tried to go, we got on a flight. I had his dad, I had his stepmom, I had me. He was tantruming. It was a disaster. And by the time we got there, we had to wait really long and blah, blah, blah. And we basically got nothing done that day. So bleh, that was a mess. So that's why I haven't had him at a clinic. But I spoke with a volunteer. She happened to call me during COVID because I've been a volunteer. And she told me about the COVID guidelines being relaxed. So we were able to telehealth with Dr. Tonjala Gibson, who totally cleaned up my son's medicines, she got rid of, he was on three seizure meds, two behavior meds, everything gone except for one, which really improved the quality of his life. Mm-hmm. And of course, because she wasn't able to get licensed in Nevada, you know, we had to stop that. However, I mean, she's still there to help me, of course. But now I'm going to go back to UCLA because the disaster that we had years ago shouldn't happen again, but I definitely need the telehealth because, you know, the reason we can't go places is because he can tantrum, and in the airports and in the cars. I mean, it's just a mess. So telehealth is so, so critical. We need it so, so, so badly. So just comment.
Can I just enlist our families? The licensing restrictions are set by state, and there are efforts to address this at the federal level, but as many of you guys know, a lot of things that seem easy to fix at our federal level in the United States are not, and this is one of those. So if you can advocate either on the federal level or on the state level to allow cross-state licensing to become easier to happen, many of us are more than willing to do it, but it becomes either regulatory-wise or cost-prohibitive-wise for us to be able to do that. So write your representatives and contact their offices, and then pay attention to the Government Relations Committee from the TSC Alliance, because they are keenly aware of this need as well. But you can help us by advocating for that at the state level and then at the federal level.
Yeah, I would second that. I mean, and it's often much more effective if it comes from, you know, moms, dads, you know, with a compelling story, you know, to your congressman, to your senator, you know, whatever, state representatives. You know, that's often far, far more effective than even the best organized lobbying effort from an association. And, you know, we've had requests at our program in Austin. You know, several like smallish hospitals around the area, different states, where they may have an adult neurologist, but they don't really even want to read a pediatric EEG. And this is something. I mean, you know, I could read an EEG in Peoria from my room upstairs. You know, it's all digital now. You know, from the standpoint of doing it, it's easy. But then when you ask them, well, you know, we probably have two a month, you know, you know, and this would be something that would let them do such a much better comprehensive job, regardless, you know, by offering a service as opposed to having to send somebody 150 miles to get an EEG. And yet we can't do that because, you know, it's as you say, it's you'd have to have like two people or more get licensed in Illinois with all of the stuff and the money and things. And what little you could charge for reading two EEGs a month is, you know, it's not going to cover even a fraction of that. And it would just be so easy, even if there's restrictions, you know, I mean, something, you know, like where you can only do one place or, you know, something like that, you know. I mean, I think, you know, there's two dozen ways we could make this better, or we could just leave it alone and have it continue to be dysfunctional. So, but you guys are probably in a way better position to start leveraging change than anybody else. Yeah. So, I can't see your face, so.
I'm beautiful, so. Just FYI.
Yeah, I recognize your voice, and I agree, you are beautiful. So.
Good afternoon. My name is Valentina Herrera. I am from New Mexico. I'm an indigenous native from New Mexico. And my grandson has tuberous sclerosis. And he was diagnosed in utero. And they first found, you know, tumors in his heart. He was born. Then they found them in his brain. And just not too long ago, they found them in his kidney. And he also has, you know, tumors on his face and other places on his body. So my question to you is, I do really appreciate the telehealth medicine because, you know, so many Native people live on reservations. When it came to COVID, some of those reservations closed down and there was no way to access any health care. So I do think that you know, telehealth is important. But my question is also maybe to Dr. García Martínez is, in your country, how do you provide services to indigenous people who live very far away? And we have never been seen by a professional person, and we're looking for, in fact, that's our whole purpose of coming to this conference, is identifying a clinic or a facility around our state, because New Mexico has nothing. And that has been so hard for us to identify a clinic to service my grandson. But going back is, Dr. García, how would you, what would that look like in Mexico, servicing people in rural communities and indigenous communities? And does telemedicine work for that? And even consultation, I would be so happy if we could get a consult with somebody from Denver or Texas, or one of, you know, to see x-rays and EEGs and tell us, you know, what the scoop is and how, you know, help us understand. But anyways, getting back, please share that, yes, if you don't mind.
Yes, thank you. Well, first of all, I want to explain something. We work in a very different way, no? We, fortunately, we don't have that issue of each state. We can practice in all over the country. Now, we are lucky that we have a good network of almost all of the people we see in our clinic is children and adolescents. And it's very different to adults in what they need, no? And we have, fortunately, also a good network of child neurologists across the country. And we communicate almost all of the patients that we see outside of the state where we live, they have their own child neurologist, no? They also consult with me or someone in the clinic, but I don't know, if at least once a year, we check up all the studies and all the information, how it's going, and always we get in communication with their neurologist. And that facilitates a lot, and they can do the EEG and manage the acute problems, and we get our opinion about the specific issues about the disease. And that works perfectly, and even we are growing that network, and it's part of our job. And now, there, our 60% of our population is in rural areas with a little access to a child neurologist. And we have a big network of families. We almost have like WhatsApp and that social network meeting. Almost, I don't know if 300 families over the country with different economic and cultural status. And that was the better way we found to tell them where to go. And that job, we have to do it, no? Where do you live? In Oaxaca, okay. You have to join that or meet this doctor. We already talked to him. He's going to explain you something. Then after you visit them, you can call us. We have a telemedicine consultation and reaffirm everything, and if they understand. And the families itself, they are working with them, helping a lot with a lot of information issues. Without that group of families, it will be impossible for us to help people to get access to specialists that know the disease. That's the way we do it. In our state, in Yucatan, is a Mayan population, a big Mayan population. and but our state is, there's no mountains, all is plain, and the far away point is just 1 hour. And everyone in all the state just need 1 hour to get to our clinic, and it's free. We make the visit, and but in other states, the rural parts are very difficult to access. They're 6-7 hours in mountains in Oaxaca and Guerrero, and it's more difficult. But we are helping those families to get access to at least for information, and also with a specialist that will follow up his particular case.
Do you have another question?
Follow up, yeah. So thank you for saying about the advocacy. That is exactly what I need to do. Not sure where to start, however, you said just kind of reach out to the TSC Alliance. Perfect. I'm actually going to an advocacy conference next week, so I'll try to make some noise. Now my other question, there's two. My understanding is that when you have Medicaid in one state, they may be able to work out an agreement with a doctor in another state. Have you guys seen that at all? To get coverage?
Yeah. So licensing is managed on a state-by-state basis, and Medicaid is managed on a state-by-state basis, and they are not the same thing. So I actually have Medicaid status in probably some like 20 states, and then I have licenses in about 5 states. They're not the same states of all things, because how it works out. What we find is that Medicaid dollars come from the federal government to the state in one big bucket. And then the states get to decide how to spend those things with some specific mandates on certain programs they must have. So there's, every state has a childhood insurance program or CHIP program. Every state has to have an early intervention program. Now they look very different from state to state on how well and how funded they are, but they have to have these things. But otherwise, they get this big bucket. State politicians see this and they want to keep these money, these dollars within the state. So they actually create a lot of hoops to jump through to make it so that Medicaid providers, if they exist out of state, they don't want that because then they have to pay me and I don't live there. Okay. And so what we find oftentimes is I'll be a Medicaid provider, then I'll see somebody in my clinic, and then we go to write for their medicines and they go to the pharmacy and the pharmacy says, oh, the state took Dr. Krueger off of our list. He is not a provider anymore. So then we have to scramble, and sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's hard to get myself back on the list. So they're constantly doing those kind of shenanigans as well. It is complicated to do that, and typically those agreements are well established for bordering states, but the farther away you get from a bordering state, harder it is to maintain those statuses. But it's certainly not something that we appreciate, that we have to go through these steps, but we do them as much as we can so that families are not caught in the middle of these kind of political backs and forth when it comes to money.
Thank you so much. One final question. I happened to be able to sit next to Dr. García last night in our socializing, and he had talked about the Lou Ruvo Center in Las Vegas, Nevada, which kind of looks like this metal brain crazy thing. And years ago, I thought, wouldn't it be cool, because it's the Lou Ruvo Cleveland Center for Brain Health, wouldn't it be cool if we could have a TSC clinic there? But then, I sent a big letter, blah, 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 it was ignored. Then I was told, oh, it's too hard, so I just kind of stepped back. But then Dr. García said, he kind of got the same thing. Oh, it's going to be too hard. Well, he's got one now. So I'm just wondering, do I reach out to Joanne Nakagawa? Do I try to, is there some advice you can give me for trying to get a TSC clinic in Las Vegas, Nevada? What all might I need?
Dr. Roach, I think this will be a good, excellent for my European colleagues, because they have had this exact same problem over and over again on how to get clinics up and running or started from the grassroots. And so I think this will be excellent for the other half of the table.
Let's start with Israel, since you're right here next to me.
I must say that we don't have this problem in Israel, because Israel is such a small country. It takes 3 hours to drive, and we have 3 TSC clinics. So I think we're kind of privileged in this part.
So let's have you guys, whoever wants to.
I'm feeling so jealous.
What the question is, what were the hurdles that you had to go through to get approval and resources to actually found your clinic?
The concept of a clinic was and is still a problem to sell. The concept of very structured healthcare, forget a clinic, the concept of a patient support group is still a hard sell back home. So how many patients I give the contact details for TSC Alliance India, and only 10% of them end up becoming members. And we've been discussing as to why is that, you know, why aren't they seeking out that extra support when they're dealing with a difficult condition, a loved one has a disease like TSC? And the answer is, I think, in two parts. One is, I think, in large parts of India, the social support network still exists. There still are extended families. The parents aren't the only ones who are fighting tooth and nail to get things done for the baby. There are uncles and aunts and grandparents and granduncles, and that whole extended social architecture still exists in certain parts of India. So probably that need isn't there to reach out to a patient support group to go and talk to strangers about something that's very difficult to talk about in the first place. Secondly, overall, the healthcare in India isn't structured. So, the idea of selling a concept which is so structured, every year an MRI, brain and look at the kidneys and get your eyes checked, becomes a problem. But we're getting there. Setting up my clinic was relatively easy because I'm one of the exceptions. I work full-time in a hospital where all other doctors also work full-time. So it looks very similar to a hospital in the UK or the US. Rest of India is a challenge because doctors go from place to place. In one day, they could be sitting in two different clinics in the city. On the next day, they could be in another city seeing patients. And that's necessary because of the dismal doctor-patient ratios that exist. But to build up a clinic where all services are going to be in the same place is even practically difficult. But we're working around it, and towards the end of the year, we hope to get a couple of more clinics working. How we're hoping to do that is we still stick to the philosophy that TSC gets managed by a multidisciplinary team who talk to each other, because it's that one patient. It's not that patient's kidney or brain that we're talking about. It's that one child or adult. So everybody talks to each other. So everybody comes together, for example, on the same day. The patients, doctors, everybody sit there on the same day. Everybody is educated and made aware, and that's what we've been doing for the last 3 years, is spreading the concept, and the International TSC Alliance International team has been very helpful in helping us do meetings locally, which have been attended by pediatricians, pediatric neurologists, adult neurologists, cardiologists, to get the concept of ideal TSC care. So hopefully will become three by the end of this year, and then it should exponentially grow, because I can tell you the most of the population is young. They go online, they're reading it, and they're seeing that, okay, somebody sitting in US is getting this kind of care. Why shouldn't my child get it? And remember, we are a country where the iPhone gets launched on the same day as it gets launched here. All right. So there is no reason, if you get an iPhone, which honestly we could do without, there's no reason why we don't get the vigabatrin and the CBD and sirolimus. So that aspiration is very much there in the population. So as long as we put in the right processes in place, the right vehicles, I'm pretty optimistic that people will buy into the concept, and it should only grow.
So I can tell you how we did it in the association, did it in Portugal. We started by identifying a pediatric neurologist that will be interested in TSC, and we asked him to identify the colleagues in the country. And we started inviting them to conferences. We financed it. They participated in contests. They got interested in the subject, in TSC, and saw that there are solutions. And then we went to the next stage. So we said, okay, so now we need a pediatric nephrologist. Let's identify the pediatric nephrologist without calling that a clinic, but behind the doors, doing it simply without investing any money, just identifying the colleagues and then referring all the patients to those doctors. And so by now we don't have TSC clinics that are called TSC clinics, but we have centers already, 2, 3, 4, 5 centers in Portugal that we have multidisciplinary teams working together and taking care of the patient. So sometimes you really need to identify. Unfortunately, it's still the pediatric neurologist, and the adults takes longer, but we're not giving up, and we're, you know, that's the next stage.
Okay, we're down to Italy.
Yeah. It's similar situation. I mean, we have five centers, and we have, we identified our neurologists, pediatric neurologists, very few nephrologists, unfortunately, but we're still trying there. We're trying, and we've tried again, okay. And we try again, and again. But yeah, we're relentless, and we'll keep on knocking on doors. But also, I think I'm going to go into Europe now. Mika and I started up a project which is called the DEA Project in 2013, which we called DEA because we wanted to disseminate the expertise and achievements related to TSC care across Europe. So what we do there is we started knocking on doors across Europe. We brought in the key opinion leaders, the major key opinion leaders, like nephrologists initially, who were knocking on doors for us and trying to get other nephrologists to come to our meetings in specific countries across the EU, and getting them to network and share their knowledge and know-how, if you like, on TSC. But even if they weren't TSC experts, we brought them on board as well, because just so long as they had a little bit of interest in that subject, we wanted them there so that they could grow and have like a good working relationship with other neurologists, and that goes on the cross-border healthcare as well. So we started crossing borders like that. That now goes across neurology, nephrology, also with some of the TAND aspects, just about everything. That's how we, I don't know if that makes sense or not, but that's how we've started to make things grow and make it accessible across the EU.
If there's a uniform theme that I've seen, and so this would apply to Las Vegas, this would apply to anywhere, there seems to be a magic formula. One is you need a parent or somebody from TSC says, we want a clinic, okay? And then the second ingredient is that you need a medical professional that wants to join your cause. And that's a one-on-one conversation. And so you heard about knocking on doors, whatever. It's not something where you do an all call and people just start lining up. It's kind of, no, you're talking to doctors that you already see, or you others that other families get you to. And then when you have that, then you get to approach the administrators of where you want to host the clinic about, hey, we'd like to do this. Can we do this? What are the things that we need to do to make this happen? What can the hospital or the clinic or help us do that? And so, and then once you kind of have that nucleus, or if you need help along that process, in the United States, it's contacting the TSC International, TSC Alliance here. Internationally, I would start with TSC International because they know the different places and all the different countries where people are maybe of like mind. But that's how the clinic started in Cincinnati. A patient asked Dr. Franz saying, would you start a TSC clinic here? And then it grew from there. And all these kind of experience you're talking about, it's asking somebody. Dr. Zhao was approached to, about doing this. So if you want to know kind of like tangible what you can do, that's where you start.
Yeah, and I would add to that you better build into your plan that at least some of the professionals who initially express an interest and even enthusiasm won't pan out. You know, there'll be people who, okay, they talk a good game, but then, you know, when it comes to actually doing anything, you know, not so much, you know. So you've been waiting very patiently, so that's your turn. So go
Thank
ahead.
Thank you. So I'm here on behalf of my niece, Mariana. We're from Colombia. We do not have a TSA clinic down in Colombia, and the medical care that she receives currently is from, of course, doctors from Colombia. However, I was wondering if there is any type of support that it could be given to us in terms of like, because of course we don't have medical insurance that will cover costs here in the US or Mexico or any other known clinics. I know in Brazil probably there's one. So if there's any help that we could get from doctors. So in terms of like doing, you know, the checkups and everything, of course we'll get them done in Colombia, but then having like a real expert in TSC that could, you know, give us some guidance and, well, and also to the doctors themselves, because sometimes, right. you know, not being an expert in TSC, sometimes, and I mean, this has been discussed a lot during this conference, sometimes us as parent, well, I'm not a parent, but as family, we are, we kind of like have to let them know what to do, and then we're also kind of like trying to get educated on what to do. So that was kind of like my first question.
So just a couple of comments and then we'll share. One, most of the people who donate their time to come to a meeting like this, I'm talking about professionals, I doubt there are very few of us who, if we were contacted by one of your family's doctors, would not take that phone call or answer that email. So, you know, I think most of us get calls, emails like that with some regularity. You know, most of them are in the States, but not all. And honestly, as long as we can solve language barriers and so on and so forth, I, for one, would be happy to, you know, weigh in on any question, you know, and it, there'd be no fee or anything like that. The other thing is, you know, what about the network? You know, we share questions we have with one another, and it goes out, you know, to the physicians, you know, hey, has anyone ever seen this or that, you know? So it seems like it might be a step forward to maybe, you know, like if you or your doctors could maybe send the question in to TSA, and then we could put it out, you know, for everybody who's on the network and just kind of get, you know, like a collective advice, something like that. Is that, Darcy, does that seem like that would work?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it definitely exists, and in its current iteration, as the TSC Alliance does it, that there's a way for the doctors to communicate to each other, and so as those come in, that works fairly well. For families, the TS Alliance, it's done with Ashley at the TS Alliance as well, where families reach out to her and her group with specific concerns about access or needing consultations for TSC, then they kind of serve as a clearinghouse to how to get those to the right individuals right. Within countries. If it's international and we know of contacts there, we try to do that. But if not, then we draw on our entire family of doctors okay. and professionals from around the world. So the TS Alliance does that. I'm not familiar with TSC International, if they have a mechanism as well that's separate from what the TS Alliance does. Does anybody know?
So the situation in India is the same. We have virtually no medical insurance covering any genetic diseases. So patients end up paying for everything out of pocket. But the way the licensing rules have changed, that's helped us, thanks to COVID. We are now seeing a lot of patients, and we are allowed to legally, like I said earlier, see patients online. From different countries, and then what we end up, and not just for TSC, even for other conditions, and then what we end up doing is we get the contact of the local doctor, and the teleconsult notes or the advice, the family and the local doctor get copied in. So you know, there's like very indirectly, very informally, there's a local network which is getting built. And like Dr. Roach said, if that doctor emails us back saying, you know, we're stuck with this or what do we do about it, there's no doubt that, you know, those doctors and the families get helped. So yes, that no insurance is a real common problem in quite a large part of the world. But then that one consult and the rest is then sort of guidance is the roadmap is drawn so that the local team continues to look after the family.
Nika, I think you can answer this one because we have quite a few contacts coming in from abroad asking questions and asking for help basically from European and non-European countries. And Mika, would you like to see our protocol for when that happens?
No, we exactly like was said here, we put the doctors in contact. So they also learn from this experience and open the doors also for next questions or doubts that they might have. So it's always putting the doctors in contact. It's extremely important. We always ask for the emails of the doctors. We put them in contact, and then the conversation is open.
Thank you.
Okay.
Can I say something, please?
I guess.
Because the language is not a barrier for us, and we want the each year we make a meeting, national meeting of families and doctors in Mexico, and this time in May we want that some people from South America and Central America can go to our meeting, because we can help a lot. Colombia specifically is very similar to Mexico. Maybe it's the country more similar to Mexico than any other one in South America. And you have great doctors of child neurologists there in many of the cities of Colombia. And we can help in a way to search who is interested of one child neurologist and go to our meeting and plan it and helping you, because also TS Alliance go to the meeting and help us a lot of how manage this issue, how to orient the families to do that. We can help a lot. We almost have you in our chat, no?
No.
Okay.
But well, we will get in touch.
I will be happy to see you and make this connection. And we have other people from Colombia, and maybe you can meet and be stronger to do that. No?
Okay.
We can help a lot.
Can I add some comment? It's extremely important to have a patient organization in the country. So if you have a couple of families together, although in the beginning it sounds really complicated, and when we started the association in Portugal, we all looked and said, we don't know anyone, we don't have any contact, we won't have finance, but it comes and it appears and it creates. And you know, we are celebrating 11 years, so it's scary, but it really improves the quality of life of the patients and the families. So it's really important to have an association, a local one.
And it also makes your voice stronger.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, young lady, you're on.
Hi, how are you? I'm from Mexico. In the place I live, it's not so easy to access a TSC expert. You have to go to Yucatan, but it's not my case. I live in Querétaro. And I wanted to ask you, we go with as many specialists we need to visit as the expressions of the condition appear. So I want to know if it's necessary or it's advisable to go to an expert clinic periodically to check up on my baby, so to know things are going right, because they are very good specialists, but they have short exposure or in the best of cases have known once about TSC, but there's not a specialized clinic.
Let me take a shot at that first, and then I want to hear from Dr. García. I think in many countries, the optimal care team is going to be a combination of a specialty clinic and then a network of others. That's partly because of geographic distance. It's partly because of access. You know, some of the clinics officially in this country will be in session, once or twice a month for a half day or something like that. So what do you do the rest of the time? Well, you still need a pediatrician. You still need, if you live a distance away and your child has epilepsy, you may need a local neurologist, to manage day-to-day stuff. But from my standpoint, absolutely, you'd want to see periodically the people who are accessible to you, who had the most experience with the disease, and then if you could lean on the people who are closer by, who, you know, where you don't have to drive so far and you have better access, I think that's actually a stronger model than depending on all of your care from the TSC clinic or none of it. It's, you need both, I think. So what do you think?
I'm agree with that. And I can say you that almost more of the 50% of the patients that we attend, they don't know Yucatan, no? But that's the reason why we get the meeting annually. And we, in that city, you can travel, and we depend on each case, we can recommend when and what we have to do if you have to go to Merida. Some patients this year is going to be the first time to go to Merida, but we already know what we are going to add and help, and we have to communicate with his child or her child neurologist and to this network to collaborate and just to assure that everything is going okay. We, at least one time a year, we be sure that all of the guidelines for the follow-up and the recommendations for treatment, they don't miss anything. That's what we do mostly. But sometimes they have to go to our clinic to see you, to see the other specialist, and just to be sure that everything is on. And if we identify some specific issue that we have to give a special follow-up, we connect with your doctors. We know each other. We're friends with a lot of child neurologists, and give this together this follow-up.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So do you have another question?
Yes, I do. So some of the information that I've gathered from some of these sessions, and I'm the one that I'm walking away with almost out of everyone, is that there's strength in numbers. And, you know, in seeking out resources. So I would like to ask the kind woman from Portugal, you know, you said that you have the association. And I can see that that's maybe what our state needs, is some kind of association. But to establish an association, you need funding. Is that funding that has come from your country? Is it funding? Tell us about your funding to establish an association, because I can see that as being the base structure of pursuing these other pursuits of trying to identify or get a clinic going or get other resources. Can you address that?
Yeah, funding is always a challenge, right? When we started, we were lucky enough that it was 11 years ago and we had a big pharmaceutical company that was ongoing with the mTOR, so they were interesting, and we had pharma then financing us. But not only. When we brainstorm, we are three mothers in the board of the Portuguese Association. We started opening, you know, our contacts. Who do we think we can help? And there were hotels, and there were banks, and there were private companies, and we needed simultaneous translation, and we contact them, we make a nice letter, and we ask for it, and you have really good surprises, really, really good surprises. So, you know, our philosophy is no is always guaranteed. You know, but we always have the 50% that for a yes. So we never regretted on sending letters and asking for from everyone. It's for everyone. We're doing this for the community. It's not for me, not for Ozelia, not for Katarina. It's for the patients. So we were, I think I do more requests for the association than from my personal life. But, you know, there's always a chance. We have 50% and it's a lot.
So in the United States, you know, you can lean heavily on the national association, because really you don't necessarily need a freestanding association. What you probably need is like a state chapter or something, you know, and that's going to probably require fewer resources, I would think, to get off the ground. So maybe could we change directions just a bit? and then we can. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. I can't see with the lights.
You're fine. I didn't want to stand up here until I was ready. But my name is Jordan, and I am a speech therapist. And I had only heard about TSC because of specialized training in neurodevelopmental disabilities. And so we were very lucky to be able to come to this conference. And what I'd really like to talk about is, or just ask about, is continuity of care, because we talk about going ideally to a TSC clinic, a TSC center of excellence, and I guess I'm wondering about continuity of care and if there has been barriers to ordering specific tests for your patients or recommending, you know, allied health professionals to be a part of a child or adolescent's care, and whose responsibility is it to making sure that that patient is receiving those services when the clinician has never heard of this disease.
Darcy, we haven't heard from you in a while.
That's a shock. there's a lot to unpack there. Because we coordinate care across a lot of different models, systems, and when I meet with families for the first time, I usually say, hey, we have three ways to operate here moving forward. One is that you're happy to see me, you got all your answers, and you are empowered and ready to go back home and just do everything with everybody that you have locally. And I'm still here as your resource, but you've got all your local team members in place to work with. The second model is the model that was very similar to what Dr. García was talking about, which is actually, and Dr. Roach, is the best model. It's when we can do a hybrid between the expertise that's available at the TSC Center or the TSC Clinic, but there is communication and cooperation between that expertise and the local providers who have much more access too, because you don't have to travel long distances. They know the local hospitals. They can order the tests and not have any hiccups in that process. They know where therapies are available and how to refer people to those therapies and get testing done. That is the best model. It breaks down in two scenarios, though. First is, not all local doctors want help. There are egos involved and financial considerations involved, and sometimes they either have done one of two things. One is they said, oh, finally, somebody else can take this hard patient off my hands. You got somebody else to do this now, which is really sad. And then the second one is when there's a fence, you know, where I want to do one thing as the local doctor, and then this TSC doctor who I don't know is telling my patients to do something else that I don't know that much about or what to do. We try to work those out best we can, but unfortunately, just be aware that those happen, and sometimes it turns into a situation similar to divorced parents, where you know, am I going to do what mom says or am I going to do what dad says? And we are certainly there to help our families sort that out. And then the final model is one where just everything else breaks down, or it's such a complicated case that the local providers are really overwhelmed, and those happen. Not the majority of TSC cases, fortunately, but those cases do exist, and where a center really is the best place to do that. And then we work with trying to make sure that we can try to facilitate as much local as we can, but it may be less than ideal because either the situation with the patient or the local team just isn't there to do that. But that's what I always recommend what we do in those situations.
One other area of breakdown I find is coverage. Insurance. I mean, you've got everybody lined up, everybody's on agreement, and in particular when you're talking about therapies and things like that, and despite our carefully considered and published guidelines, you still encounter insurance companies that say, you had an MRI scan 2 years ago, we're not going to approve it, you know, and it's probably even more frequently seen in things like speech therapy and occupational therapy. I mean, that's, at least in my experience, that's unfortunately a far greater occurrence than, say, the ego of the local doc, you know, which I agree is an issue. So, there's another person, I think.
We had a virtual attendee question, and they asked, What do you see are the benefits of clinic care? TSC New Zealand are at the beginning of this journey in New Zealand. I've started talking to doctors, but haven't had much enthusiasm yet. Some families are very keen, but others who haven't known any other way don't know about the concept. As a mom, I can see why it would be great, but I'd like to hear your perspective to help with my advocacy.
One of you guys? Why don't you take it?
It would be great if we could have TSC clinics all over the world that were listening to the guidelines and treating people with TSC as they should be. But it's I think it's also utopia, isn't it? If you can get it, then yeah, that's the ideal solution. But if you can't set up a clinic, then I think that you're going to have to go where you can get the best help that you can, or try. I don't know. I think that the ideal solution is to have something specific for TSC, where you can have every single aspect treated holistically. Because it, as Pradnya was saying earlier, you're not treating one symptom, you're treating a person. Maybe that's something that we need to bear in mind, as a whole. And it's not just one symptom, it's a group of symptoms. That's why I would say, yeah, if you've got the opportunity to go for a clinic, then go for a clinic. But I don't know.
When you're treating a disease, whether it's tuberous sclerosis, or when you're treating a person with a disease, whether it's someone with tuberous sclerosis or something else, you're always in a better position if you have more knowledge about what you're treating. And I think that for the most part, that's the value, I think, of the clinics and the centers, because they have experience. They've partly because they have an interest in it, so they tend to know more about the disease to begin with, plus they have more experience. And so that doesn't mean that every single bit of patient care needs to be in a center, but from my vantage point anyway, if it's my child, I want to have access to people who know the most about the disease, and I think that's what the clinics offer.
I would add from a New Zealand perspective, the TSC Association Australia has been around for a long time and have had lots of exposure and contact with families from New Zealand. And so either whether it's an option to travel from New Zealand once in a while to see one of the TSC clinics in Australia, I certainly would endorse that. But even not so, the TSC Association Australia would know families in New Zealand that are getting care for their TSC individuals, and that they would probably know of specific physicians or specialists that, while there's not an established TSC clinic, there are individual providers in New Zealand that have that. And that's, again, one of the things, you know, with between TSC Association or TSC International or the individual organizations in individual countries, if you feel like you don't know where to start, that is an excellent place to start.
Yeah, I agree. So I started to do this a while ago. How many people in the room have either yourself or in your family an adult with tuberous sclerosis? So quite a number, I think. So I'd like to maybe hear from you guys, what are the barriers you have encountered because of the age, if any? Is that an issue anymore? Go ahead.
Well, this is not neurologic, but
it's okay.
My son was followed by a pediatric dental place, and with COVID, we didn't get to see the dentist, long story, whatever, so now he has gingivitis, and he's 24, and the pediatric dentist says, okay, well, now go on to a periodontist, goodbye. So that's kind of a problem, because, but that's dentist, but that's just one example that's really recent.
Okay. How about the other folks who raised their hand? Any stories to tell there? I can't see who they are.
I think the best example is that the pediatric clinics continue to see adults, unfortunately. It's because of lack of information and and finding the right doctors to follow the adults and the interest community. So we are working really hard on finding adults, neurologists and nephrologists, but it's not easy. So you could see, like, my daughter was in the pediatric clinic until not recently, and she's 26 years old. And this is something that I really think that there is a big gap in the community and we have to work on it.
Well, Joanne got us in touch with you last year whenever our 22-year-old son was diagnosed, because he was already aged out, couldn't find any neurosurgeons, neurologists, anything for him. When you say Dr. Roach is my neurologist, then he's got really easy, the dental clinic there in Norman, Oklahoma work with him, the eye doctors work with him, and then they do their scans there and send it to you. So the telemedicine works out real good for us here in Texas, our son in Oklahoma, and then you being down in Austin. But it wasn't easy until we found Joanne to find you.
Someone earlier mentioned Joanne. For those of you who don't know, Joanne is retiring.
I heard that. That was very sad.
if you're one of the many people that Joanne has helped over the years, and you run into her here at the meeting, you should. This would be a good opportunity to tell her thank you. So, because she is truly an extraordinary person. So
if you're looking for the new Joanne, that's Ashley at the TSC Alliance. Okay. Ashley Pounders has assumed very large shoes to fill, but that liaison is not going away, so know that just Joanne has a new name.
Yeah, and a new face and a new email address, but it's the same Joanne. So this whole issue of adult care, I think it's going to be probably the next battle as far as access. You know, when I first started working on this in the United States anyway, we had a clinic here in Dallas when I was here. There was a clinic in Chicago. The one in Dallas actually antedates the one in Cincinnati by a couple of years, because I remember having a long conversation with Dave when he was starting. And there was a few others. But the TSA set up fairly ambitious goal to promote clinics. And I remember the marching orders were everybody with tuberous sclerosis needs to be able to reach a knowledgeable clinic or professional within a day's drive. And I think we've largely achieved that. But I will also acknowledge that it's been achieved much more reliably for children than for adults, because the people who really probably know the disease the best, as a specialty, are people like pediatric specialists. Because we see them first, we deal with many of the issues. And, you know, then when you switch over to an adult neurologist, well, some of them know it pretty well. Dr. Crino knows tuberous sclerosis about as well as anybody. But there are not very many Dr. Crinos. excuse me. And so I think the next challenge is going to be we need to have another challenge, you know, which is within the next decade we need to have an option for adult patients to get knowledgeable care within a reasonable period and if you're a reasonable distance and certainly as adults, you know, many adults with tuberous sclerosis, particularly with severe manifestations, don't mix well with airplanes. I mean, you know, that story I've heard many times. And so I'd be interested to know what people think about what's the best way to do this, because how do you get a pediatric specialist to see someone that they don't feel like they're trained in, like a 40-year-old, or how do you get an adult specialist to take on and become enthusiastic about treating something that they don't know anything about? What's the answer?
Okay.
try and answer this. So in UK, where I was trained, and I'm referring to pediatric epilepsy, not TSC. But they have a lovely transition care model where once the dialogue starts, when the child reaches, starts getting to about 16, and the family in their annual visits is made aware that, you know, very soon transition is coming up. And they have a set of transitional adult neurologists who work, and they specialize in transition care, but they're primarily adult neurologists. So by the time the child hits 18, the child who's no longer a child, is seen in clinic jointly by the pediatric neurologist and the transition care adult neurologist. 2-3 visits are with the family and 2 neurologists. So, you know, it's almost like a very smooth transition, a handover. The family starts feeling comfortable that now they know the new doctor, and then the care is eased off. Though I was trained in that, I'm not able to implement it back home at all. It is very difficult to, so I end up seeing patients who are 36 and so on, and completely off my comfort zone while treating them. But I do wonder whether this UK model is something to, there are problems with it, of course, getting so many professionals together at the same time, you know, coordinating schedules. In India, we will have to solve the problem of the consulting fees and so on for 2 doctors at the same time. But I do wonder whether we could adapt this model in some way where that transition is, it will get the families comfortable. I've seen that happen. And probably that's a great way to pass on the specific challenges of TSC, you know, knowledge sharing between the adult neurologist and the pediatric neurologist.
You have a question or a comment?
I think that as one who works in the US and also in Israel, I can see we have a lot of disadvantages, but the problem in the US, I think, is because most of the TS centers are located in children's hospitals. Yep. And in the old world, a lot of the TSC centers are located in general hospitals. So we have both pediatric and adult doctors working in the same center. So it's much easier because we as pediatricians train the adult doctor to take care of our TSC patients, and we see them together in the same clinic. So there is a continuity of care, and actually even the children that I took care of them and they become adults, they are the next door in adult nephrologist, but I'm over there and we talk about the patient, and there is a real continuity of care. And I think it's kind of complicated to do it in the US when most of them are very highly specialized center, that there are no adult center, and it's very difficult because of insurance and other issues to work together, children and adult together. And I just want to move back to the previous question. I'm sorry, but I think that me as a specialist, a TSC specialist, let's say, I have 3 main commitments. One is for my patients, that I need to take care of them. And of course I do it every day. The second commitment is to the other pediatrician and adult doctors in my country to promote education, to teach them about signs and symptoms, and to let them know that the TSC center actually exists, and they need to refer them to me, and that I'm over there, I'm not stealing their patients, and can help them, they can contact me, and this is my second and my third commitment, and because we don't have insurance issues, maybe like the US and licensing, we help a lot to other countries around us that can contact us if they do not have TSC centers. And of course, eventually this is the parents and the government in these countries' commitment to open their own TSC centers. But at least 20% of my patients are non-Israeli, that I help them by emails or without any financial cover. That's it.
So one other thing that makes it a little bit difficult in this country is, at least my sense, is that medical training in Europe is still a little more holistic. You know, that most people who are pediatric specialists have had a little more pediatric or adult training or vice versa. And so there's not quite the fear factor, perhaps. Whereas in this country, it's evolved to the point where if you want to be a pediatric specialist, you go directly into pediatric training. You know, your training is going to last 3 years, plus maybe more if you're a neurologist. And it's not until you get, as a neurologist, you know, many times, it's not until you get to the neurology part of your training that you're ever actually asked to see adults. And so I think that's probably even worse because for other specialties, because neurologists are one of the few residencies that actually require a cross-training. And so I think that has created a situation where a lot of the specialists just feel like a fish out of water, as the saying goes.
I would say that we do recognize that this is an area, like you said, over the next 10 years, we need to not just assume it's going to get better, but we need to actively, proactively figure out how to take care of our adults with TSC. One of the things that is still obviously in a state of evolution, but with the updated recognition process that we have for TSC clinics and TSC centers of excellence, is that we expect centers of excellence to have a transition plan that is not just something written on paper. That it actually has, if it's not where they continue to be seen in the same clinic or the same center with adult colleagues and collaborators, but then there is a clear process on how patients are handed off to adult specialists, and that it's not consisting of parents saying, here's a list of doctors and phone numbers and good luck. That is not for us a standard that is appropriate for a center of excellence. So we recognize this and we are working towards this process. And it's a problem that's not just unique to TSC, of course. A lot of patients that have complex medical conditions as children lose a lot of that carefully managed care when they move to adult care settings. But in TSC, we are actively working towards finding the right path.
That's exactly what we did also with the DEA project, was this networking, because we know that there are more than 6,000 rare disorders, and we don't expect you all to know and to be updated with all the disorders, but when you have a patient, then we do expect you to go and read and be updated. So we created these small meetings across Europe where we are bringing doctors from all over the countries together with the local associations, and these meetings are for free. They are short. They are around one day, a day and a half, so it doesn't take long, and the flights are short because it's within Europe. But then they feel more comfortable because they already have the knowledge and they have the networking and they're working with the key opinion leaders, so they open another door that they can, if they hesitate, they can contact. And this networking system is really important to also get the doctors involved.
Yes, and you also give the patient community the opportunity to meet key opinion leaders in their area and get to know them face to face and speak with them. So that's really important as well, you know, if they have any issues. Unfortunately, though, we do have problems well across Europe with transition, which is a word that we hate. So continuity of care would be better because it is a legal right. And it does take away a lot of dignity if you, you know, I know that we in Italy, I'll speak about Italy specifically, we have an accompaniment period where we have child neurologists accompanying the family with the patient through to adult neurology. But I think that we are a very, very long way off from something that isn't even near perfection, which is probably horrible, horrible, because it's not happening. So,
question?
Actually, a statement, and this is before, you know, the session ends. I would just like to thank you all for sharing your knowledge with us. You know, there's hope. I can see just in this room, because you're not frazzled. My daughter and I run around, you know, we're asking questions. Who do we talk to next? And it's so refreshing to hear medical people say that they are committed to their patients. You know, we don't always hear that from medical professionals. It's like, they always classify their remarks with, well, we don't know a lot about TSC, but this is your next appointment, you know, with the nephrologist or whoever it might be. So thank you for your endurance. And as I sit here listening to you, I think about how can I tap into the Indian Health Service? You know, there's a lot of Native children that have, well, maybe not a lot as other places, but there's a lot of Native people who have this. And I know that they have money, a little bit of money, and you know, how do we tap into identifying one of them as a TSC specialist for throughout Indian country in the United States? So it's given us a lot of things to think about. So thank you, and I really appreciate your commitment to this this condition. Would it be called a condition or a?
We get the idea. It's a disorder, I guess. So, thank you for those lovely comments. And incidentally, if you'll see me afterwards, I have a name here for you for a neurologist that I suspect is relatively familiar with tuberous sclerosis in Albuquerque. So I'll get you that. So we've got a couple more minutes. Other questions? I don't think there's a law that says we couldn't stop 2 minutes early if there's no more questions. Anybody on the panel have things you've just been dying to get out and the moderator hasn't cooperated?
I think that it's really important because we're all sort of family, let's put it that way. It's really, really important to say, and it's probably really, really difficult because Mika and I especially have been through this ourselves, so we've been through the same experiences that you've all been through. Don't give up, keep on fighting, because health is a right for every single person on this planet. So if you think that something is amiss, if you yourself feel that you're not getting what you should be getting, keep on fighting until you get it. Do not give up. And contact your association and speak to whoever you can speak to if you're feeling right down there, because they might bring you up there a little bit further. So just do that.
I just have a quick question. So my daughter is 3 and has tuberous sclerosis. She also had a liver transplant. When she first got diagnosed with infantile spasms, she was put on ACTH, in which we were told that we could only get because we had private medical insurance. When she had her liver transplant, we had, I would like to call an interrogation about our financial situation before she could be listed for transplant. And we are moving to the UK at the end of the summer, in which I was informed by an insurance broker that transplant and other medical care is considered a human right rather than something you can buy your way into with a better insurance program. So my question is basically just how we can work or how we are working towards within the States providing care for TSC patients or other patients as an as needed basis by as what they need rather than what they can provide with their economic status.
That's a very sad story to hear. So I apologize for everybody involved. I will point out that even within the United States, there's a vast difference in the approaches to that sort of thing. You know, and some of them are, you know, pretty monetary driven. Others, you know, everybody has to pay their bills, but others much less so. So, and, you know, beyond that, I don't think I can make much of an apology. So, we're out of time, and I think the TV camera is going to shut off here. So, most of us will probably be around a few minutes afterwards. So, to close, I'd like to thank all of our panelists for coming here to Dallas and giving their time today. And considerable expertise, I've learned a good bit. And I'd like to thank you guys for being advocates and for showing up. And you know, the mere fact that you're here tells me that you care about what's going on, and that you know, and that's an important place to start. One last reminder to fill out the attendance things. you know, this will determine whether Dr. Krueger gets invited back to the next one. And so please, you know, cut him some slack. And also I think it makes you eligible to win something, but I'm not sure what. So anyway, with that, we'll close the session. Thank you very much for everybody for coming, and have a good rest of the meeting.